Hi guys, welcome back to my channel. My name is Laura and I eat only meat. Well, meat, cheese, those types of things, animal products only. And I travel probably twice a month for my everyday corporate job. I'm a corporate sales trainer. And so typically twice a month, I have a trip that lasts 2 or 3 days. I like to bring my own food simply because of the fact that a lot of times we're doing group meals, we're ordering in. I'm not in control of the restaurants. And so the more prepared that I am, the less that I have to worry about it. I am leaving in about 36 hours, and this is an international trip. I'm teaching overseas in Europe for a week, and so I am going to be bringing a lot more food with me than I normally do simply because I have 24 hours of travel on the way there and back, and then I'm not really sure what's going to be my options for lunch during the day, so I want to make sure that I'm prepared. We're gonna start off by going over all of the cold things that I bring, some pre-prepared food. Then I'll show you like all the packaged foods that don't need to be refrigerated at all that I bring. And then lastly, I am going to walk you through the process for making the ribeye jerky, which you could implement that with any cut of meat that you like. First, I wanna talk about how to keep cold things cold. You can take ice past security, or if you're on a road trip, you could bring ice packs with you and bring a cooler. I typically bring a little cooler like this in my purse or in my carry-on, and I used to take ice packs with me. The challenge with ice packs is that when they melt, you then can't take them back through security with you. Or depending on what hotel you're in or how long you're gonna be traveling, they're gonna melt and you have no way of refreezing them, and that ends up being complicated for me. So I have recently switched to using these refillable, like medical bags. I don't know if that's what they're called, but refillable bags. I fill it up with ice from my house before I leave for the airport. And then because it's frozen, I can take it past security. The other thing then is if it melts, I simply just dump it out, and any bar, restaurant, hotel, gas station is gonna have ice. Like, ice is a really easy and cheap thing to find. If it got melted because I was out all day and flew home at night, I could dump it out, go through security, and then once I was past security, find a bar or a restaurant and get it refilled with ice, and then I could throw it back in my cooler and keep everything cold. Also, I always bring my own water bottle, and then I fill it up with ice before I leave the house. And then once I get past security, I grab my electrolyte packet, and then I can just fill it up, pour it over my ice, and then fill it up with the water fillers that they provide for you for free after security, and I'm not stuck waiting in line at all the restaurants and everything like everybody else. Along those lines, I always have a bag of mixed electrolytes with me. I tend to bring like some flavored versions, lots of unflavored versions for myself. I have a couple of coworkers who love having them. Funny story, I was traveling for work one time and literally everybody on my team got food poisoning from eating these like pre-made salads that they ordered in, except for me, because I didn't have any lettuce. They all got violently ill and were throwing up so much so we had to cancel our meetings for the next day. I gave everybody electrolytes, so then as they were like throwing up, they were able to stay hydrated and then actually like travel and make it back home and feel better in the midst of this like terrible food poisoning. So they were very grateful that I tend to travel with excess electrolytes with me. We're a big fan in general. When I'm traveling for the family, I will bring a bunch. My mom, the kids, Chris, and I all tend to have extras when we're traveling, just simply because it's so easy to get dehydrated. You don't realize like how much you're not drinking sometimes when you're traveling. And so I always make sure to have these on hand. Element is actually sponsoring this video, which I'm super grateful for. And they have an offer for all my subscribers where you can get this free sample pack that lets you try all 8 of their flavors. When you make any purchase, you could buy their new seasonal grapefruit, which is their summer flavor, that's only out for a limited time. And then you could get a free sample pack if you go to drinkelement.com/LAURAESPATH, and you can get a free sample pack. So thank you to Element for sponsoring this video. Okay, now for all of the cold foods that I tend to bring. I will say 2 foods that I don't bring that are pretty popular is hard-boiled eggs and tuna pouches. I'm not a hard-boiled egg fan in general, just personal preference, but that's a really great zero-carb option. Same thing with tuna pouches because they're easy to travel with. I tend to be on airplanes mostly and in enclosed spaces with my coworkers or strangers for lunch. And those are 2 really smelly foods. So if you're car traveling or gonna be by yourself, then hard-boiled eggs and tuna pouches are great options for you. Just be respectful. If you're flying, maybe don't pick that. I am pushing the limits of that though, and I have some pre-made chicken salad. Oftentimes I bring my loaded chicken salad on a trip with me. I just didn't have time to make it this time, and a local butcher sells these little containers of chicken salad. So I'm gonna bring this. I will eat it with some pork rinds or dip it in some carnivore snacks, and it just kind of makes something snacky like pork rinds feel a little heartier and give me some extra protein and fat when I'm eating it with a chicken salad. I'm just hoping this isn't gonna be too stinky. Next up, something I bring on most trips these days is just some bacon. I cooked 3 pounds of bacon this morning. I'm gonna leave part of it here for the family to have for quick breakfast the next couple of days. It easily fits in my little cooler and next to an ice pack. I bring lots of cheese. If you're dairy free, close your eyes for just a second. I love these mozzarella balls. I just throw a handful of these into my little cooler bag for pretty much every trip that I go on. Even if we have like a catered office lunch and there's provided something that I can eat, I just love having a couple little extra pieces of cheese just to give me a little something to hold me over if necessary. I always travel, not quite with this much, but I will grab some slices of this Tillamook cheese depending on the length of the trip. I will, and sometimes too, I like buy it when I'm there because I'm going overseas. I just want something for the length of the trip on the way there. So I'm gonna throw a few slices in my Ziploc bag. And then I will throw some pepperonis in a Ziploc bag. Also, you could use cheese sticks. I tend to leave these around for the kids just because I don't mind having a Ziploc bag. But since this is a longer trip, I also am gonna bring some deli meat. This is something that travels really easily. It's good to keep cool, but it doesn't have to be like a perfect temperature all the time. I will throw some roast beef, pick whatever deli meat you're most comfortable with. I try to find one with the cleanest ingredients, but I'm fine with it. And I'll throw that in a Ziploc bag. Also, these are really handy, and I take these. This is like prosciutto and mozzarella, pepperoni and mozzarella, or this is salami and provolone. I could easily throw one of these in the bottom of my, or the top of my cooler, and those travel really easily as well. Also, if I want to feel really fancy, I can bring this boursin cheese spread, some pork rinds, or some beef slider carnivore snacks, and scoop with this. The chicken slider carnivore snacks are leaner, and so then I could add some cheese with it, and this would give me like a really nice cheese meat option, and then I could have some roast beef. This would be a great like lunch to have at the office when I'm traveling, all things that I could take with me. Something else I bring on literally every single trip that I go on is my salt and butter tower and my little travel salts. I keep these in my purse or something I could throw in my pocket when I go into a restaurant. And then this tower, it's made for like supplements and pills. I talk about it all the time. You guys have probably seen it. But I keep fine grain salt in the top. I keep coarse flaky salt here. And then I keep butter in this section. You are allowed to take only 3 ounces of butter or even that boursin cheese that I showed you. You can only have 3 ounces at a time. So if you wanted to bring a lot of butter, you'd have to put it in separate containers. You could have multiple 3 ounce containers, but this is considered spreadable or liquid, and so you can only take this. But butter and salt are obviously things that can be more stored at room temperature. So I don't worry if this doesn't fit into my little cooler bag or if I'm not bringing cold stuff. I just would put it in the fridge when I get to the hotel at night. And then these little refillable Redmond salts. I have one that doesn't have a label on it. It looks a little sketchier. So when I'm traveling with coworkers, I make sure that I find one with a label on it. For things that don't need to be cold, I bring a lot of my homemade jerky or meat chips. Those just have to be eaten more in the first half. If I'm gone for 2 or 3 days, I could bring those with me. It just, the downside is it takes a lot of work and time and prep to go into it, and I don't always have that. So for a longer trip like this, I need something that can stay fresh for my flight home. And a lot of my homemade jerky is gonna spoil before then at the end of this like 8-day trip. So I throw carnivore snacks in my suitcase. They travel really well, especially ones like the chuck, brisket and the ham, because they are long, flat pieces of meat. And so I can kind of put them in my suitcase and smash them down. And then I will save these till closer to the second half of my trip. Also, pretty much on every trip, I bring some beef sticks of some kind. Personally, I just prefer the Paleo Valley ones because they're fermented and not cured. So they're just a little easier, a little healthier. options. I do, depending on where I'm at, like buy stuff. So I might buy some pork rinds or buy a few things in the second half of my trip. I'm gonna bring on this trip some of the 4505 tahine pork rinds that I showed, that I bought at Sam's Club in my last video. Somebody told me Costco has them too. But these will just be fun. I will just bring a Ziploc bag of those for this trip. How do I carry all of this is a question. On shorter trips, I typically will just bring these two little cooler bags. I can't link them, I'm sorry. I'll link my carry-on tote bag that I bring usually. These came with like my bigger purse travel carry-on that I take with me everywhere all the time. This trip, so normally for shorter trips, I just put like a little cooler bag in my carry-on and take it with me on the plane, no big deal. For this trip, since it is longer, I am checking a bag. And then I am bringing this little wheelie bag. This fits technically according to TSA rules under the seat in front of you. So this is gonna count as my second item. So I can bring this and a bag to go in the overhead bin. So this is my second item. It technically fits under the seat. And I am literally just gonna fill it with food. I'm gonna shove my coolers in here and shove all my food in here. And this is gonna be my food bag for this trip. I have no shame. Something that I bring with me often on trips is some type of dried meat. I'll take pork loin and slice it thin and dehydrate it and bring it. Or I'll do that with eye of round. Today I'm actually gonna be making some ribeyes. I wanted something that was a little fattier, a little heartier since this is such a long trip and I wanna make sure that I'm fully prepared with enough food. So I got these thin cut ribeyes from Sam's Club. I'm gonna pound them out so that they dehydrate a little faster and they're not quite as chewy and I'm gonna put them in my dehydrator. I have a big fancier dehydrator, more expensive dehydrator, and it works great. It has like a temperature adjustment and an automatic shutoff. But I also have this like $40 dehydrator that has four racks on it and it works just as well. The main difference is just that you plug it in and it turns on and you unplug it and it turns off. You can't like pick a different temperature for it. And I can't have an automatic shut off. So I can't like put it on and go to bed and have it turn off halfway through the night. But my mom uses this one regularly. I use this one sometimes still too, if I'm not making quite as much. My other fancier dehydrator just holds a lot more meat also. Because these are thicker ribeyes, I'm probably gonna dehydrate them for about 24 hours. But other meats, if they're leaner or if they're sliced thinner, I could dehydrate in 5 or 6 hours. How long things take for you to dehydrate them until you like the texture depends totally on the humidity of where you live, how thick the meat is cut, and just what cut of meat it is. So I tend to do all of my jerky or dried meats at between 140 and 160 degrees Fahrenheit until it's the texture that I want it to be. So I just start checking it after a few hours. I don't put any seasoning or anything on them until they are completely finished, but you could throw some barbecue seasoning, taco seasoning, like chipotle, red pepper flakes, like whatever's your favorite. I will just dust them with salt when they come out tomorrow. I'll start checking them when I wake up tomorrow. It's 4 p.m. now, so in about 13 hours from now, I will start checking them and just see when they're done. I checked on these before I went to the gym this morning and they were already looking great. By the time I got home, they actually were looking pretty finished. Because they are so fatty, they will never get completely dried out. You can see that juicy fat dripping off of them. So I used a paper towel to soak up some of that and dusted them with some fine grain salt. These took about 15 hours total in the dehydrator. That amount of time is pretty flexible. It could have gone a couple hours more, a couple hours less, and likely turned out the same. I did sop up some of that liquid fat just so that they didn't end up soggy, but that fat is so juicy and delicious. The texture of these is a lot more like traditional jerky. It's not like the flaky type of carnivore snacks. I don't know how they do that. That's magic. Once these had cooled for a couple of hours, I vacuum sealed them individually just to make them easier for meals for me on the go. I would keep them out of the refrigerator for a couple of days, but if you're not gonna be able to eat them in about 2 days, I would put them in the refrigerator. Because they're so fatty, they'll spoil fairly quickly. Okay, so that's kind of it. I have my stack of dehydrated ribeyes. I'm gonna throw those into my bag my food bag down there. And then in the morning, I will just put ice into my ice bags in my water bottle, throw the coolers in there, and I'm off. I'm gonna try to document as much of this trip as possible for you, so subscribe if you haven't already, and you can follow along with me as I go on this trip, and I'll keep you posted about like what worked out and adjustments that I would make next time. Hope this was helpful. Talk to you guys later.